The text that I was given to expound upon is found in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 6. John 14 and verse 6. It's a very familiar passage to you. Now let's read it together. Jesus said to him, meaning to Thomas, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." The words that I just read must be among the most hated statements in our pluralistic, relativistic, anti-authority, postmodern, post-Christian society. In fact, I think many believers will not even dare to repeat those words in their place of work for being afraid of being rejected or being considered narrow-minded or not sophisticated enough. But that is the milieu in which we live today. In a pluralistic society, people with differing beliefs and different cultures should be able to coexist peacefully and have freedom of religion, and that is all well and good. But when you move from there to the idea that every belief is just as valid as the next, then you know you're in for a society that has no value for truth and therefore no value for Christ. Now, in some ways, that is not new. Pilate asked the question, "What is truth?" And he did not wait for an answer. He turned around and left the immediate presence of the person who embodied the truth. So 2,000 years ago, Pilate had no value for truth either, and no value for Christ. We live in the middle of what some have called a soteriological pluralism, which means that people can get to God through different avenues, through different pathways. A U.S. religious landscape survey conducted in 2007 by the Pew Research Center reported that most Americans who claim a religious affiliation take a non-exclusivist view of salvation, with 7 in 10 saying that many religions can lead to eternal life, while less than one quarter say theirs is the one true faith leading to eternal life. Now, the Roman Catholic Church has been moving in that direction ever since the Second Vatican Council in 62 to 65, when the church clearly stated that those who, through no fault of their own, do not know the gospel of Christ or his church, but who nevertheless seek God with a sincere heart and moved by grace, tried in their actions to do his will as they know it through the dictates of their conscience, these too may achieve eternal salvation. So one can see that the Catholic Church, rather than reforming itself in the right direction, has been distancing itself from the biblical revelation. Now, sadly, many evangelical leaders have come to believe and teach the same doctrine. If evangelical Christians come to believe this, they need to realize that the only way they could do that is disregarding the teaching of Christ. The New Testament teaches in different ways, in different passages, the exclusivity of the Christian faith. But many have capitulated to the pressure of our times. Others consider themselves what have been called particular inclusivists. They call themselves particular because they believe that the work of Christ, the Christ-saving work, is essential to be saved. That's why they are particular. But at the same time, they are inclusivists because they believe that even they, or those people who do not know Christ, may come to salvation based on, through different mediators, but based on the saving work of Christ. Clark Pinnock, in the 1990s, he stated that we couldn't negotiate the saving work of Jesus Christ. So he would be considered a particular. But at the same time, Pinnock, along with others, believed that Christ's work on behalf of mankind allows people to be saved through different pathways that lead to God. So he would be an inclusivist, a particular inclusivist. In other words, Christ's saving work is what allows others to be saved through different mediators, contradicting the words found in 1 Timothy 2:5, for there is one God and one mediator, also between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. It is amazing to me to see how many inclusivists take the exclusivist claim of Christ and change their meaning to suit their heresies. Deepak Chopra, for example, says this: when Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father except through me," is nothing more than Jesus attaining God consciousness. That is nonsense, given what we know about the teaching of Christ. For many, Jesus is just another great teacher, as Mark Dever pointed out last night. And that may be politically correct, but it is not biblical. Listen, salvation requires people to believe not in a Jesus that is superior to others in some respects, but rather you must believe in a Jesus who is equal to no one. He's something other than all men. When I hear somebody saying that all pathways lead to God, I like to say, oh, sure, but for a different reason than the one you're thinking. And the reason is that all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So the Hinduist, the Buddhist, the moralist, and the rest of humanity will get to the presence of God before his judgment seat. So the question is not if the path I'm following will get me to God. The question is, when I stand there before him, on what basis am I going to do so? Because if you do not stand by faith, you will not stand at all. You must stand by faith on the finished work of Christ. So all pathways will bring you to God, but only one will bring you to glory, and the rest will bring you to damnation. As you all know, at the time of the Reformation, Martin Luther led the church out of a fatal error about the doctrine of salvation, and that brought in a whole different worldview, a worldview that had God at the center of history, the gospel at the center of preaching, and the word of God at the center of the life of the church. Many of the practices that the church had followed for centuries were challenged and even changed. At the time, the church taught that salvation was in Christ, but through the Catholic Church, plus good deeds, plus the sacraments, and the reformers protested and said, no, salvation is in Christ alone. So the words that we have in John 14:6 speak to that phrase: I am the way and the truth and the life. And those words are were part of a long conversation that took place in the upper room between Christ and his disciples the night before his crucifixion. Those hours before he went to the cross must have been very gloomy. That night, Christ told his disciples that he was going to leave them. And then there was an announcement of treason, followed by an announcement regarding his death. And then in addition to that, Christ stated very clearly that one of them was going to deny him, and that the entire group at one point, at a critical point in his life, was going to abandon him. Now put yourself in the middle of all of those announcements that went on. I don't think that they could quite follow the master, and he was unfolding in words the events that were to take place hours later. I can only imagine how tense the atmosphere must have been. I think they were afraid, probably terrified, and Christ knew it. Christ knew it because you see how that portion of the scriptures begins in 14:1. This is what Christ said to them: do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. He was trying to give them assurance, but the assurance was in him and nothing else. And the same thing is true for you and for me. Now, moments before, this is what Christ had said to them, recorded in John 13:33. Little children, I am with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, now I also say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. Imagine that. You just heard he's going to die, he's going to leave you, and he's going to a place, and you cannot come. Now, Christ was a master of leading people to ask the question that he really wanted to answer and that they needed to know. So right after those words came a question, and then another, and then another, and then a fourth one. What do you think that we do when we don't understand something? We ask questions. Who do you think asked the first question? Peter, who else? Simon Peter said, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, where I go, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow later. John 13:36. He's giving them information. He's creating questions in their minds so that they may ask them and he could answer the questions. So the conversation progressed in the upper room, and a little while later, I should say, in John 14, in 4 and 5, this is what he added. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How do we know the way? Now you can see they are really confused. You're going to a place. We don't know what that place is, but we're supposed to know the way. So Jesus told them that, and now he's saying, you don't know where I'm going, but you know the way. So Thomas asked a logical question, verse 5. Lord, we do not know where you're going. How do we know the way? So there is a question that Christ wanted to answer. So the first question was asked by Peter in 13:36. Thomas asked the second in 14:5. Philip asked another question in 14:8. And Judah, not Iscariot, asked a fourth question in 4:22. In fact, Peter asked two questions. Of course, it was Peter. Lord, where are you going? Question one. And two, Lord, why can I not follow you right now? But the key question was asked by Thomas. How do we know the way? And here's Jesus' answer. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. One step at a time, Christ led the disciples to ask questions that had answers that they all needed to know, and you and I too. Now, this time, the answer was one of self-identity. If there is something that is impressive about Christ, is how frequently he spoke about who he was more in some sense than what he did. In fact, quite frequently when he did something for someone, he would instruct that person to say nothing. That he did quite frequently, but he did speak a lot about who he was. Listen to some of the things he said in the Gospel of John about his identity. I am the bread of life, 6:35. I am the light of the world, 8:12. I am the door, 10:9. I am the good shepherd, 10:11. I am the way, the truth, and the life, 14:6. I am the resurrection and the life, 11:25 and 26. I am the true vine, 15:1. Our text is the sixth I am of our Lord of this list that I just gave you. Every single I am phrase that appears in the Gospel of John is an expression of self-identity. It has been said by more than one author that the Gospel of John contains more revelation about what Jesus thought of himself than any other book or letter in the New Testament. Christ spoke of himself. He was the object and the subject of the revelation of God. The Jewish people, the Jewish rabbi, couldn't talk that way. They continually talked about the Torah, or the Torah of the law of Moses. They thought the authority was on the Torah. The rabbis debated their arguments based on the Torah, but Christ, however, didn't think so. The authority was not on the Torah, but in him. So when he came, he dared to say, "You have heard that it was said, but I say to you." The other teachers spoke about the content of the Torah. Christ spoke about the essence of his being. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He was the Lord of the Torah, and he was the giver of the law that he came to fulfill. The rabbis were speaking about the content of the law. He was speaking about himself. Once again, these I am statements were Jesus' self-identity. When a rich young man came to Christ and asking what he should do to inherit, to obtain eternal life, Christ did not say, "Follow the Torah," but "Follow me. I am the way." So eternal life is not found in rituals, in a book, in a teacher, in a mantra, in a prophet, is found in Christ and Christ alone. Jesus did not say, "I tell you the truth," although he did. He said, "I am the truth." He did not say, "I'm showing you the way," although he did, but he said, "I am the way." And he did not say, "I am capable of giving you life," although he was, but rather he said, "I am the life. I am the life." If that is true, then anyone who is not found in Christ is dead. No one spoke like Jesus did before or after. In reality, no one could, because only God can speak the way he did. James Edwards wrote a book called "Is Jesus the Only Savior?" And in there, he says that most religions try to encapsulate their main teaching in one single phrase. So for Judaism, the key phrase was the Shema in Deuteronomy 6:4. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one." For followers of Islam, the phrase is, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. For the Buddhists, they speak about the Four Noble Truths. Even in the communist system, they try to do that, and this was their phrase, from each according to his ability and to each according to his need. Now, I think it would be impossible to summarize all that Christ is in one sentence. However, I think that we could potentially summarize Christ's identity in relationship to his mission in this one phrase. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That single phrase tells us who he is, what he came for, and how you obtain eternal life. You have heard of the four spiritual laws. I'm sure that most of you have. I'm telling you, these are the four spiritual laws. I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He did not say, I am a way, I am a truth, I am a life. Those are the indefinite forms of the article. He used the definite form of the article. I am the way, the truth, the life. I think that is the most exclusive statement that Jesus or anyone else has made in the entire history of mankind. He leaves out any other teacher who came before or after him. That was kind of my introduction. Let's take those phrases separately. The way, the truth, and the life. So let's start with the way. Before the fall of Adam, he had access to God. But eventually he sinned, and when he sinned, he couldn't find the way back to God. So Adam lost the presence of God, and he lost the way to get back to his creator. He lost the map. In the garden, Satan offered a temptation that was very appropriate for a garden. It was a fruit. Now, in a sophisticated society like the one we live in, I think his temptation and his enticements will be more refined, savvy. So Satan has been offering to man different avenues according to the times and cultures. Morality, philosophy, religion, your best effort. And I think he came, and underneath of those names, he added a last name, if you will, and he looked something like this: morality to God, philosophy to God, different religions to God, your best effort to God. So the real spiritual warfare that we are engaged in is the fighting of all of these belief systems that are trying to compete with the single truth of God. As the result of the fall, man is lost in darkness and ignorance. And being in that condition, the only way to return to God was if a person would come from God and knowing the way would come and take us there. And that is precisely what Christ did. This is the way he said it. No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man, John 3:13. Then at a later point he added, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, that where I am you may be also. He came and he's taken us there. Now, the psalmist knew we have lost our way. And that's why he cries out in Psalm 27:11, teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a level path. If God did not show us the way, we will never find it. And if God will show us the way and then will leave us alone so we can follow it, we will lose it again, like Adam did. So what did he do? God the Father sent the Son, and he's the one taking us by the hand until we arrive home. He told us to follow him because he is the way. He's taking us, and then he promised one more thing. I'm taking you, but I'm telling you, until you get there, I will never leave you or forsake you. No, don't. We'll get lost. And he knows it. So here's the way, the path, the road. And what is a way? It's something that links or joins two different points, and that's exactly what Christ is. He is the person who reconciles man to God. He is the one who takes man from darkness to light. He is the Redeemer who takes us from the slavery to freedom. He is the person who finds an orphan and converts him into a son and an adopted son. And he's the one who brings you from death to life. He is really the way, and that is exactly how the early community of believers was known, as the way. In six different times in the book of Acts, we are told that the believers were called the way. In Acts 9:2, 19:9, 19:23, 22:4, 24:14, and 24:22. In fact, they thought the way was a sect. They were familiar with that terminology. Now, people reject the idea that Christ is the only way because in our fallen condition, we are born with a desire to be independent and autonomous. Rebellion is our nature, and crucifixion is our cure. Rebellion is our nature, and the crucifixion of the Son is our cure. James Montgomery Boyce, in his commentary on the Gospel of John, it speaks of three different ways that man had planned to show or to reach God. The first is the path of nature. Some people think that they could worship God contemplating the creation rather than worshiping the Creator. And sure, they much rather do that because nature will never hold them accountable. God would. The second path is the path of morality. Here we find those who believe that a moral life defined by them will bring them to God. The problem is that the best moral person ever is still falls short of the glory of God. We know what Romans 3:10-12 says, as it is written, none is righteous. Not one, no one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. They lost their way and they are now worthless. Now many people have entered eternal damnation thinking that they had accumulated enough good deeds to get to heaven. The problem was that their good deeds at the beginning were really bad deeds at the end. Their best lives now brought them to the worst ending then. In fact, to a horrible ending. Brothers, there is only one thing worse than being lost without God, and that is being lost without God and believing all the time that you are safe. More than once, I have sat in front of a pastor. I remember this one occasion when this younger pastor than me came and said he wanted to tell me his story. And I listened, and at the very end, I looked at him and I said, so-and-so, I'm going to ask you a question that could be offensive, but you know me. We have known each other for 12 years. You know that I do not want to offend you, but I want to ask you, are you sure that you are a believer? He opened his eyes and he said, why do you ask me that? And I said, because the story that you just finished telling me is not consistent with the life of a believer. But you know what? Take a week, pray, talk to the Lord, come back next Friday, we'll talk again. And you know what? I'm not God. I do not live inside of you. Whatever you tell me, I'm going to believe you. He came back 7 days later, and he said, Miguel, I am not a believer. What do I do? I said, well, you need to resign from your church. An unbeliever cannot pastor a church. And he did. Went into the world for a little bit, and then he got converted, and he's back in the fold. That happens. That happens to moralists. Paul was in that path for a while until he found the truth. And he says in Romans 7 that sin deceived him, and his sin used the commandments of the law to kill him. Sin deceived him to believe that he was following in the right path. The way to religion is the third path that Montgomery Boyce mentioned in his commentary on John. And here you find people who think, if I go to church, pay my tithing, and I get involved in some church activities, I have heaven guarantee. And unfortunately, many of those will end up with a condemnation, being super religious. They were convinced but not converted. Others will simply follow other religions like Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, or any other. Christ is the way that is always before man, but because the unbeliever is in darkness, he cannot see the way that is in front of him. The lack of light does not allow him to see the way. And the solution to that is his word. That is where the light is. Listen to the psalmist in Psalm 119, 105. The word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now we dealt briefly with that first phrase, the way. Let's tackle the second phrase, the truth. Adam fell when he embraced, when he ceased to believe the truth and embraced a lie. It was that simple. The mess in which we find ourselves today, with the entire creation groaning, is the result of one simple action in one single day when Adam took a truth and exchanged it for a lie. And that is the origin of idolatry. Romans 1:25 describes idolatry as the corruption of the truth. Listen to what Paul says. Because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. That's what they did. That's the action. And worship and serve the creature rather than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So because they exchanged the truth for a lie, they ended up committing acts of idolatry. Man ended up there as the result of basically changing the revelation of God for a lie that he have manufactured. We have idols in the heart, in our hearts. Every idol of the heart is related to a lie that the mind has embraced. Every idol of the heart is related to a lie that the mind has embraced. And in so doing, man has become a slave to his own value system that he built on a distorted view of reality. We do not see things the way they are. We see things the way we are. And since the psalmist in 116:11 says that all men are liars, then we tend to see the truth as a lie and the light as the truth until regeneration. Christ is the lens that allows us to focus and see the lie for what it is and the truth for what it is. The believers in the Old Testament believed the truth of God. They did. But things were not very clear to them because they did not have a full revelation. So many things looked to them like shadows of the truth. And they were shadows. But Christ, being the culmination of the revelation of God, shined his light on those shadows, revealing the realities behind them. So he's the truth that allows us to see the rest of the picture. Without the truth, man cannot be saved. This is so true that Christ summarized his entire mission in one simple phrase: I came to testify to the truth. Can you imagine that? That if you would have asked Christ, why did you come? He would have said, I came to testify to the truth. John 18:37. For this I have been born. I was born for one reason. And for this I have come into the world, to testify to the truth. Knowing the truth is paramount because it affects the entire spectrum of the human existence. Listen to the words of Vince Vitale in his book, Jesus Among Secular Gods, about the importance of truth. This is an important quote. If all truth is ultimately grounded in the person of God, then every question asked is a question asked about a person, and every true answer is received from a person. Every question about science is a question about how and why God has made and sustained the universe the way he has. Every question about morality is a question about the character of God. Every question about politics and economics is a question about what it means to be made in the image of God and granted dominion over the earth. Every truth, no matter the discipline, says something about who God is and what he has done. That is so well said. That's why he came to bear witness to the truth. We cannot do anything without the truth. Christ came to speak the truth, but he also came to embody the truth. So we now can follow the way and we can follow the truth, and both of those two things are found in one single person, and that is him. Now notice how the psalmist links together those two things, the truth and the way. Teach me your way. Oh, yes, Lord. I can't find it on my own. Teach me your way, oh, Lord. I will walk in your truth. Psalm 86:11. Why? Because his way is the way of truth. And only a true way can bring you to a true God. That's how the psalmist is putting these two terms together. And the apostles came to know that the way and the truth and the life were in just one single person. And that's why Peter says in Acts 4:12, there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. He's the true God, and you get to him by the true way, and that is Christ. In the same way that light dissipates darkness, and then reveals everything that is in that place, life or truth dispels error and reveals what man is really like. Without truth, you and I cannot know anything. We cannot have a moral order or a moral world. Maybe this illustration, real story, will help you see what I'm trying to say. In May of 1996, a dozen mountain climbers died trying to climb Mount Everest. And reading this story, eight of them died the same day on May 11th. The other four died subsequently as a consequence of their injuries suffered while climbing. Two other Japanese climbers were ascending and passed by two of the climbers who were injured, freezing, and in danger. Evidently, the two Japanese climbers had enough provision to share with them, but they decided to go on. This is what one of the Japanese climbers said when questioned. "We were too tired to help, and now listen. Above 8,000 meters is no place where people can afford morality." You cannot have morality when you do not know the truth. The absence of Christ in those two climbers was the real reason why they couldn't stop to help two dying human beings, bearers of the image of God. Our brothers, we might be able to do the same thing if our lives are not focused on Christ at the time of the experience. Christ came to infuse the world with truth and therefore with morality. Knowledge of the truth is what allows you to know morality, or what morality is, or what is moral. Man without the truth is an immoral creature. At the beginning, at the end, or all the way through. And if you don't believe me, just look at the society we live in today. Now, Christ not only said that he was the way and the truth, he also said that he was the life. That's our third key phrase. We mentioned earlier that Adam sinned and lost his way back to God, and then ever since, he could not discern truth from error. But Adam's problem was worse than that. He became spiritually dead. So when God created Adam and Eve, he placed them in the garden and gave them specific instructions with one prohibition: do not eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So what do you think they did? They ate of the tree and lost their life. God said, do not eat, and they did. The second Adam came and said, I am the bread of life, eat. And what do you think man did? Did not. We eat when we are not allowed, and we do not eat when we are offered, because the creature loves his independence and his autonomy. That's our nature. Our parents die because they ate a forbidden fruit. We come to life by eating the bread of life, as Ligon Duncan expressed so beautifully. We need the forgiveness of God, but we need the life of Christ. We need the cross, but we need the resurrection, because we were dead in sins and trespasses. Apart from Christ, there is no resurrection and there is no life. And if there is no resurrection and there is no life, there is no gospel. And if there is no gospel, then let's just all go home. The incredible thing about Christ is that he gives us life by dying. He's the only death that gives life. I cannot be born again without his death. And the life that he shares with us is the life that he shares with the Father. In Jesus' days, the funeral homes did not want him close, because every time he showed up, the dead person would come back to life. So he wasn't good for business. Because as light dissipates darkness, so life dissipates death. The unregenerate man is dead. And because of it, he has no desire for Christ. In fact, his mind is set on the flesh. And that mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to God, but listen now, for it's not even able to do so. He's dead. A dead mind, or the mind of a dead person, couldn't respond. That carnal mind has no interest in the things of God until we become alive in the new birth. Now, time has been running, and we need to rush to the end, but we still have one portion of the verse that we have not covered, the very last portion of John 14, 6. No one comes to the Father but through me. I think those probably were some of the most offensive words that Christ could have ever pronounced. Now imagine, if that was then, what would be that like today? That single statement establishes the Christian faith as the exclusive, as an exclusive faith. There's no other way of salvation. As Lord John said, there is no knowledge of God apart from him. There is no communication with God apart from him. And then the doctor added, unless this Christ, the Son of God, is in the central place as the only way to God, there is no gospel. And if there is no gospel, there is no life. That is why the resurrection, that's why he is the resurrection and the life. Imagine how offensive those words would be in our world today. The world hates it when we say that Jesus is the truth. A pluralistic society does not like an exclusive truth. I am convinced that we are in the truth. I would die for that. But if we aren't, somebody is, because the truth is always exclusive at any point in time. Now, if you think about Hinduism, for example, they are willing to take Jesus as one more deity because error always has room for truth. But the truth has no room or time for error. If we had a bank for fake bills and you would take a real one to them, I'm sure they will take it. But our banks don't take fake bills, because they believe they have the real ones. In the upper room, Jesus showed them and showed that he was an expert, as we said earlier, in leading people to ask the question that will provide the answers that they needed to know. So the night before his crucifixion, Jesus told his disciples that they couldn't go where he was going. And you know, Thomas asked the question, how do you say that we know the way when we do not even know where you're going? Jesus responded, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There is only one way, and it is Christ. There is only one truth, and that is the one that he proclaims. And there is only one life, and that is the one that he gives. Now listen, in a pluralistic society, establishing the way, it is of necessity. In a postmodern generation, establishing Christ as the only source of absolute truth is vital. And in a collapsing and dying Western culture, speaking and remembering that Christ and proclaiming that Christ is the source of life is hope given to people. It is the pulling away from him that's bringing the demise of our culture. When truth became incarnate in the person of Christ, every religious system, including Judaism, was replaced. A new authority was in place. And because of it, no one has been able to speak like Jesus did before or after. Take these examples. Buddha died looking for more enlightenment. Well, that would require light and truth. So he was looking for Jesus and didn't know it. Jesus could have said, I am the truth you're looking for. Muhammad thought of himself as a prophet, and he was born in time and space, 570 AD. But Christ thought of himself as God. In fact, that was why the Jewish people wanted to nail him. And he accepted the worship of man, and yet he did not consider equality with God as something to be grasped, but rather he became a man and ultimately his servant, and died on a cross. Apparently, Confucius stated on one occasion, "I never said that I was holy," but Jesus asked, "Which one of you convicts me of sin?" And the answer was, "No one." Buddha taught for about 25 years, Muhammad for about 22 years, Confucius, which I think was confused, that's where the name come from, taught about the same number of years, and when the three of them, they taught for about 80 years, Jesus taught for three, and no other person has changed and affected and impacted the course of the civilization as Jesus Christ in 3 years of teaching, but 2,000 years of influence. Confucius died divorced. Muhammad had 11 wives, although the Quran only allowed for four. And Buddha, who said man should be free of his selfishness, that man abandoned his wife and son, showing his unselfishness. But Christ died without sin. Pilate couldn't find fault in him. His wife said, "Have nothing to do with what? That righteous man." Herod did not find any fault either. He found him innocent. One of the thieves on the cross acknowledged that Jesus had done nothing wrong. And the centurion at the foot of the cross said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Jesus was born in a manger, in an obscure village, and yet his is the most famous birth in history. The academicians are still arguing about his birth, and he's already reigning from above in heaven. God the Father called him my beloved son. The prophets called him Messiah. Isaiah said that that child that was going to be born would be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His disciples called him Master, but eventually Son of God, but he called himself Son of Man. John called him the Logos, who was at the beginning, who was with God and indeed was God. Demons called him the Holy One of God. The entire universe recognizes him as Lord. He fulfilled the law and became our Jubilee. He was nailed to a cross and paid for the sins of God's elect. And then the cross, an instrument of curse, became an instrument of blessing. And now we call him Savior. When he died, hell trembled. And he disarmed the powers and authorities and the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. He was buried in a borrowed tomb that was closed with a large stone, and 3 days later, he left it open and empty. He fulfilled every other prophecy about him, put an end to the law, and cried out, "It is finished, tetelestai, I've done it." And before he ascended into heaven, he gathered his disciples and said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." He has all authority in heaven and on earth, and therefore no one comes to the Father but through him. We either go to heaven through him, or we go to hell without him, and that is the brutal truth. Therefore, knowing now, men, you and I, knowing now the fear of the Lord, we must persuade men. We must persuade men that he is the way to get back to the garden, to the ultimate garden, to the promised land, to our final home. That he is the truth that will set man free from the bondage of sin, to the freedom of God, and that he is the life in whom we live and move and have our being eternally. And at the very end of the revelation of God, he came to John and said, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the one who is and who was and is to come. He is the Christ we preach. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you send your Son to show us the way. We thank you that he came and told us the truth about our depravity and the truth about salvation in him. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you came, sent by the Father and the Son to give us life everlasting. You are indeed God in three persons, merciful and mighty, and the blessed Trinity. In your name we pray and preached. Amen.